Hanover Square Press and Harper Audio present The Lost World of the Dinosaurs, Uncovering the Secrets of the Prehistoric Age, by Armin Schmitt. Read by Shaun Grindell. A note before we begin. For a glossary, timeline, and more, don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider. For Elizabeth and Maximilian. Prologue. Since the age of 5, I have been fascinated by the giant dinosaurs of prehistoric times. I am very grateful that my passion and purpose were revealed to me so early on, and that I was able to turn this enthusiasm for dinosaurs into my profession. Today, when I find a dinosaur bone in the field, I still have the same glow in my eyes as I did as a small child when I first saw real skeletons of these giants at the Senckenberg Natural History Museum in Frankfurt. The path from dino-crazy child to vertebrate paleontologist, however, was not straightforward by any stretch of the imagination. Nevertheless, I had the great fortune to be part of many discoveries, some of them very important, even if I myself was not at the centre of the research. Some research projects I was involved in contributed to a better understanding of the evolution of dinosaurs and other prehistoric reptiles, and fundamentally changed our view of dinosaurs. Some of that is reflected in this book. It's a great feeling to be at the heart of research in the golden age of paleontology, using cutting-edge technology to uncover new mysteries and unravel puzzles that just a few years ago were thought never to be explained. One reason we've recently learned so many new things about dinosaurs is the incredible rate at which new dinosaur species are being scientifically described. In the last 20 years alone, more dinosaur species have been discovered per year than ever before. Since 2003, about 45 new dinosaurs have been discovered each year. This is mainly due to increased funding for research, more scientists today, and more teams in the field. Remote sites are more accessible, and we have increasingly accurate geological maps with precise coordinates for these sites. It is not uncommon for new fossils to be discovered at already known localities, and it is not uncommon for this to bring new species to light. Also partly responsible is the rapid increase in computing power and speed of computers and workstations, which make it possible to generate simulations and three-dimensional models, and to evaluate complex statistics to generate phylogenetic trees of dinosaurs. And recently discovered dinosaur species not only fill museums and provide new names that are difficult to pronounce, but also provide insights into how different animals were related, as well as their habitats and survival strategies. Each new find gives us ever more precise insights into the ecosystem of the dinosaurs, and their external appearance even helps us better understand their internal structure and the function of their organs. This is enormously important because some dinosaurs had such unusual anatomies that we cannot find anything comparable in nature today. New discoveries help us understand how dinosaurs were able to cope with drastic climate changes and adapt to new habitats. Dinosaurs were fascinating creatures that can serve as model organisms to understand many mechanisms of nature and evolution. In this book, based on several prominent examples of species of dinosaurs, I discuss the fact that there are always new discoveries to be made, and that, despite our extensive knowledge of dinosaurs, many questions remain unanswered. The Great Dying. When the earth was burning and the sea was choking. To understand how dinosaurs became the most successful terrestrial vertebrate group in Earth's history, we must travel to the beginnings of dinosaur evolution and clarify what factors were necessary for dinosaurs to begin their triumphant reign. Most children today know that all dinosaurs, with the exception of modern birds, became extinct at the end of the Cretaceous period, about 66 million years ago. An asteroid hit Earth at that time and sealed the fate of the dinosaurs and many other animal groups. Ammonites disappeared from the oceans. These were cephalopods, related to today's nautilus and squids. They lived in our planet's oceans for well over 300 million years, and were an important component of complex food webs and marine ecosystems. Along with the ammonites, large marine reptiles, such as the four-flippered plesiosaurus and the varanid-like mosasaurus, also disappeared without any descendants. But as terrible as this cosmic impact must have been, it is dwarfed by an event that had much greater consequences and is widely considered the worst catastrophe for life on this planet. It was a cataclysm of apocalyptic proportions, so devastating that some authors refer to it as the Great Dying, the Permian-Triassic mass extinction. Michael Benton, one of the most influential paleontologists of our time, wrote a book about it, giving it the striking title, When Life Nearly Died. This event, which took place at the end of the Permian period, resulted in the greatest mass extinction event in the history of the Earth. About 90% of all species living at that time became extinct. For the first time in Earth's history, many insect species were also affected. During the Permian, food was still plentiful for all animals. The Earth was a green planet. For millions of years, plant growth had been so abundant throughout the world that the oxygen content in the atmosphere continued to rise and reached its highest level in the entire history of the Earth. Today, we assume that the atmospheric oxygen level was around 30% in the Permian. By comparison, the oxygen level in the atmosphere today is only about 21%. Droughts, fires, air pollution, and acid rain subsequently destroyed the lush forests, causing the atmospheric oxygen content to drop from 30 to about 10 to 15%, and then remain at low levels for many millions of years. Oxygen levels would never again reach those from the beginning of the Permian. The effects were so far-reaching that it took almost 15 million years for the Earth's forests to fully recover. The Great Dying, and the subsequent collapse of the ecosystems, is thought to have been caused by mega-volcanism in Russia. The so-called Siberian traps, or flood basalts, are a testimony to this catastrophe. These are extensive lava flows that stretch from the Barents Sea in the northwest to Kazakhstan in the southwest. From there, they continue to Novosibirsk and Irkutsk in the south. In the east, they extend beyond the Lena River, almost to Yakutsk. Some of you may recognize Irkutsk and Yakutsk from the board game Risk. The volcanic eruptions occurred in three spurts, over a period of about 900,000 years, and covered an area of 7 million square kilometers with volcanic rock. This is equivalent to almost the entire area of Australia. The volcanic eruptions responsible for this are considered to be among the largest known volcanic events in Earth's history. The eruptions took place about 252 million years ago at the Permian-Triassic boundary, and their consequences are causally linked to the mass extinction at the end of the Permian, or the Great Dying. The post-apocalyptic world after the Permian catastrophe must have come very close to our idea of hell. The megavolcanism in Siberia released substantial amounts of carbon dioxide, fluorine, hydrogen chloride, and sulfur dioxide, which reacted with rain to form sulfuric acid, permanently damaging or destroying both marine and terrestrial habitats. Carbon dioxide emissions triggered global warming, increasing the global temperature by 9 degrees Fahrenheit in a very short period of time. We now also suspect that the ozone layer was severely damaged by the greenhouse gases and the fly ash, resulting in an increase in UV radiation, in turn hampering plant growth and causing pollen malformations. Massive forest fires accelerated the large-scale vegetation loss, and acid rain finished off most of the plants. At that time, it only rained periodically, during the mega monsoon season, but then the celestial floodgates would open wide and pour forth torrents of caustic rain for days and weeks across the supercontinent of Pangaea. The rest of the year was marked by terrible heatwaves, droughts, fires, and an unbearable average temperature of 113 degrees Fahrenheit. While there was still sparse vegetation in the coastal regions, the interior landmass was dominated by vast deserts, wider than even the Sahara or Gobi deserts. The consequences were devastating. The extreme environmental conditions increased erosion on land. This resulted in extensive draining of the soil into the sea, leading to eutrophication effects such as algal blooms in marine habitats. At the same time, there was a mass proliferation of marine protozoa in oxygen-free environments, whose metabolic products, in addition to all the gases from a massive volcanism, released methane, halocarbons, and large amounts of hydrogen sulfide, H2S, into the atmosphere. In the meantime, anoxic, oxygen-free conditions developed in the oceans, causing all reefs and their inhabitants to die off. Rocks that bear witness to this momentous event are called black shales, which are dark-coloured, organic-rich sediments. With the formation of anoxic marine zones, the rapid decrease in pH and the release of methane hydrate, a mass extinction began in the oceans. As a result of the methane escaping into the atmosphere, the Earth's temperature rose by a further 9 degrees Fahrenheit, and the upper water layers of the world's oceans even warmed by at least 14 degrees Fahrenheit. The Earth was burning, and the oceans were boiling. The ever-increasing concentration of greenhouse gases led to a domino effect, which we describe as a galloping greenhouse effect. That explains why the megavolcanism in Siberia lasted almost a million years, but the mass extinction only 30,000. Initially, the changes were gradual. But as more and more habitats were damaged and more pollutants were emitted, temperatures increased faster and faster, and the collapse of the ecosystems became unstoppable. In the end, about 95% of all marine species and about 75% of all terrestrial species became extinct during this event. Among the few survivors were the direct ancestors of dinosaurs and crocodiles, the so-called archosaurs. Without this catastrophe, the triumphant rise of the dinosaurs would probably never have happened. And so it is perhaps an irony of fate that, on the one hand, the dinosaurs entered the world stage after a devastating mass extinction, while on the other, they then fell victim to a mass extinction themselves. There have been 5 such events of mass extinction in the history of the Earth. 3 of them are closely related to the origin of the dinosaurs, and were crucial for their unprecedented evolutionary success, but ultimately also responsible for their demise. 1. The Permian catastrophe about 252 million years ago, the Great Dying, favoured the development of the archosaurs. The archosaurs, or ruling lizards, include all crocodiles and dinosaurs. Birds also belong to this group, but they did not yet exist in the Triassic. The archosaurs, and dinosaurs in particular, were able to hold their own well in the hostile world of the Triassic, because their efficient lungs were better able to cope with the low levels of atmospheric oxygen. They could run faster with their long straight legs, and their bodies were farther from the hot ground than those of other lizards and amphibians. These traits were advantageous in the oftentimes desert-like regions of the prehistoric continent. This allowed them to colonize new habitats. Their scaly skin prevented their bodies from drying out, which was an invaluable advantage in the sweltering heat of the Triassic. 2. The End Triassic Mass Extinction, which occurred about 201 million years ago. This catastrophe killed the conodonts in the sea, which had existed for about 340 million years, and now disappeared without descendants. As either the first vertebrates, or close relatives of today's vertebrates, they are among the earliest forms that later gave rise to fish, amphibians, reptiles, mammals, and birds. Further impacting dinosaur evolution was the extinction of 4 major groups of crocodilian relatives at the end of the Triassic: Rauizuchians, Phytosaurs, Aetosaurs, and Ornithosuchians. These representatives of the crocodilian lineage were similarly as successful as the dinosaurs in the Triassic. At the same time, almost all temnospondyls, a clade of giant amphibians that could grow up to 13 feet long, became extinct. They are considered a sister group of today's frogs and salamanders. For simplicity, they can be thought of as 13-foot-long monster salamanders, with bony plates on their skin. With the demise of the monster salamanders and most land-dwelling crocodiles, there was no longer any competition for the dinosaurs, and so they became the undisputed rulers of the Earth at the beginning of the Jurassic. 3. The end Cretaceous mass extinction, about 66 million years ago, finally sealed the fate of all dinosaurs that were not true birds and not in the bird lineage. The end of this book explores why the dinosaurs did not survive the asteroid impact. The fossil record includes all scientifically documented finds of fossils worldwide. The occurrence of fossils at a certain place is usually...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.